Antonio?
No, just sí. In a minute.
Sí, ¿tú quieres liderar la primera discusión y yo la segunda o cómo quieres cambiar?
¿Cómo muy quieres? Bien, vale.
¿Está bien? Sí.
Perfecto.
¿La primera serás tú?
Vale, bueno. ¿Sí? Hola, ¿cómo estáis?
Ay, Joan, ¿cómo estás?
Muy bien. Brian, ¿qué tal?
Muy bien. ¿Qué se ve bien?
Sí.
Tú de bien.
Te puedes poner aquí tranquilamente, ¿eh? Si quieres, que si quieres sentarte para ver las presentaciones y todo. ¿Eh? So good afternoon, it's 3 o'clock now here in Spain, 2 o'clock I think in Portugal. We are in our second day of our course of individualized immunotherapy. I think today it's going to be a day as much as good as yesterday. We have great speakers with us, and well, I think Dr. Costa is going to introduce our first speaker.
Yes, good afternoon to everyone. Thank you again for being with us. As I do agree with Dr. Antonio, you will have a great afternoon. And it's my pleasure to introduce my good friend, Dr. Christian Blank. I met him a few years ago, the pre-COVID area, where we could invite speakers to come to our hospital, and he gave wonderful talks about melanoma. And if you have some time to see, he's an outstanding researcher in the field and is involved in most of the most important publications, including adjuvant therapy in melanoma and treatment of metastatic melanoma. Christian is a leader of research at the National Institute of Cancer in Netherlands. And without further words, I give the stage to Christian. Thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you very much for the invitation. Unfortunately, I can't come to your beautiful country and we have to do all virtual, but that's the times that we have here. So I will share now my share slides with you. Okay. So today I will talk about breaking news in melanoma immunotherapy, and I will focus on the data that we have seen this year. So I have to give me 1 second. So these are my disclosures, and I would like to strengthen on that I'm co-founder from ImagineBV, because I will talk about also about some data that we've seen at ESMO that are important for this company that focus on targeting TRAF2 pathway. In stage 4 melanoma, what have we seen this year? So first of all, it was very important to see the long-term outcome from KEYNOTE-06, the phase 3 melanoma trial comparing pembrolizumab versus ipilimumab. This was a mixed trial where you had first and second line patients included, but here you see now the first line, because this is more the reality what we see, and you see that with anti-PD-1 monotherapy, we can about, cure most likely about 40% of the patients, what you see in the flattening of the curve, and the lower curve you see in, for ipilimumab, about 33%. Importantly is, and that is also what I teach my young fellows, is the first round has to be give you a deep response, because what you see here is the subgroup analysis from this trial. And if you achieve for your patient a complete response or a partial response, then your overall survival at 3 years is in the range of 95 to 100%. While if you achieve only a stable disease, then it's only 66%. So if you have the feeling that early on you don't get deep responses, then escalate very fast, because that's the important thing step that you have to do. What are the options? We can give for sure the combination and from anti-PD-1 plus CTLA-4. And here we have seen also this year the 5-year data and also the characterization. And you see again, and now with an even better outcome, if you achieve a complete response either with NIVO or with the combination, then the outcome is excellent at 5 years for the overall survival with 85 to 86%. But what you also see is that it doesn't matter so much with which treatment you achieve the CR. So you have to learn, when do I need the combination and when do I need the monotherapy. And what we've learned in the last years is if you have a patient with low tumor burden, normal LDH, normal CRP, then you can, no brain mets, no liver mets, then you can give the monotherapy. If you have brain mets or liver mets, then you should go for the combination, because then you have better chances to achieve a good response. A new thing is, and what the companies are doing, going to flat dosing and making the infusion dates longer and longer, to reduce the burden of the outpatient clinics. And here we have seen now some data from pembrolizumab in a Q6 dosing. Normally we give at the moment nivolumab flat dosing 4 weekly and pembrolizumab 3 weekly, and based only on a mouse modeling of a surrogate antibody, there was also the approval for the 6 weekly dosing, which was pretty weak. But now we have also patient data, and there you see that the 6 weekly dosing comes a little bit over to the historical data from the control when this trial KEYNOTE-001 and 006 were. But you see also that it will be never used the perfect combination, just to give it a better impression. That is what I don't like about such biased presentations, because then if you compare first line dosing in this KEYNOTE-555 code, you should also compare it with the first line dosing of pembrolizumab in the KEYNOTE-006 trial, for example. And there you see it's indeed in the range, but here you have now really the good comparison, 40% overall response line for pembrolizumab in the first line, and 38% in the Q6 dosing. So there we are in the same range. What have you also seen? The combination of targeted and immunotherapy, and what we expected already, and this is now the third trial showing this, is that the toxicity is very high. We see a slight benefit for the triple, but I'm definitely not fan of that, because for patients that get continuous combination of immunotherapy and targeted therapy, you don't have any options afterwards anymore. And this trial was also even not reaching the statistical significance, the predetermined, even that it showed a tendency for the triplet. Here you see the toxicity, and this is definitely in the triplet way higher than for the doublet. And with all these trials, we have also the problem that they compare targeted therapy first line and BRAF V600 melanoma with the triplet, which is not the standard anymore. We normally try all now to start with immunotherapy, but what we have learned is that targeted therapy after immunotherapy is equally effective. But if you do this in the vice versa, that you start with targeted therapy and then start with the immunotherapy later, if the patients escape from the immunotherapy, from the targeted therapy, then the immunotherapy works less well. My highlight this year from ESMO was the SECOMBAT trial from Paolo Acerto, where we now don't combine everything in a little bit brain-free approach, but thought a really nice trial. I think it's always what you see, that investigator-initiated trials are often more thoughtful than the big phase three trials. And here, what Paolo Certo has done is he tested in three arms the sequence of targeted and immunotherapy. So in arm A, you see that he started with BRAF-MEC, and in progression, he started to the combination of CTLA-4 PD-1 blockade. In arm B, vice versa. So this was a standard question, what should I start? And then what was very elegant is he asked also the question, can I use target therapy just as an induction therapy, reducing tumor burden, getting some immune infiltrate, switch then to immunotherapy, and then go to encobina only if the progression is. And what we see is that exactly what we hope for. You see that the arm B, the ipi-nivo followed by encobina is a slightly less good than if you start target therapy. This is always what we see. And then the crossing comes in. This is also in this trial here. But what we nicely see is now for the triple progression-free survival that this drop in the beginning, we don't see when we give the induction. But it seems, and this is pretty early, but I believe in plateaus, to be honest, it seems that the arm C with this short induction and then switching to immunotherapy might become the winner arm. And then next year we will have more major data, and then we will see. But it's pretty nice to see that you prevent the early loss, and it seems that you have the best plateauing with that approach. And that makes this trial so attractive. Now comes the question, is the toxicity higher? And this is very nice to see that again, when you see the arm B with the 54% toxicity, which comes from the immunotherapy first, targeted therapy 28. But if you make the switching, and this is what's surprising to me, it seems that you don't get a higher grade 3-4 toxicity. So the tumor reduction burden with the target therapy, then quick switching seems not to have the same increase in the toxicity that what you see with the triple combinations, what I've showed you with the presentation that from Paul Nathan. So that's what we've seen stage four disease. Now comes stage three disease, first adjuvant. We have three trials, and these are slides that Georgina Long gave me. So I will really credit her for this slide. Where you see that from adjuvant Daptrum target therapy, adjuvant PD-1 and adjuvant and also PD-1 from pembrolizumab, you see benefit for the for all patients. Be aware here, this was placebo controlled, and this was against ipilimumab, where we have seen already an overall survival benefit in the adjuvant setting. So what do we want to give? And this is the question that we still don't know. There was never a head-to-head comparison, and you see it's in the same range. Pembrolizumab seems to be a little bit more, but be aware that the inclusion here was also a stage 3B included resectable stage 4, where this was 3A till 3B, HCC7 criteria. Same for Daptrum. So in that way, I say that it's all in the same range. The question is for sure, what is the toxicity profile? And there it seems that anti-PD-1s are a little bit better. And it's what we believe from the stage 4 disease that maybe the immunotherapy gives better. A little bit disappointing is that this big advantages from the PFS or relapse-free survival, to be better precise, does not translate into an overall survival benefit. But I want to remind you that IPI gave already an OS benefit, and it could be because then the patient switched. Interestingly, it will be very interesting of whether the pembrolizumab study adjuvant will give an OS benefit, because there the crossover was allowed at progression. And if there is no OS benefit, then you could imagine that you could also say, I don't give adjuvant therapy and I just give it when needed in a later stage phase, yeah, and follow my patients very very strictly, which would save a lot of money and also a lot of overtreatment, because the absolute benefit is 20% about, So you can imagine that 80% of the patients are treated for nothing in the adjuvant setting. The next trial that I found very interesting was the ImmuneNet trial, now addressing the question in a high risk population, resectable, including stage 4 disease, can I add nivo-ipi? It was led by Dirk Schadendorf. And the same what we have seen from the neoadjuvant setting, this combination with IP3 was very toxic and but very effective. What you see, a really nice relapse-free survival benefit. So you would think if we reduce now the dosing from IPI, what we've done in the neoadjuvant setting, to 1 milligram, that you could get the same benefit for in the adjuvant setting. But this seems not to be the case, because the CheckMate 915 trial that addressed exactly the question using a lower dosing of IPI did not meet the primary endpoints. We have not seen the data yet to really analyze why this is the case, but it could be that neoadjuvant is at the end stronger than adjuvant treatment. Yeah. So let's switch gears now to neoadjuvant setting, and therefore I would like to remind you first that you set into context the data that I will show you once more, these adjuvant trials. And I would like to remind you that all these trials started at week 12 post-surgery and excluded all patients that had early relapses before the starting the adjuvant therapy. So they were not in this trials. And if you read this really carefully, then you have about 15 to 25% screen failures in this period. The majority due to progressive disease. So if you even are conservative and say 10%, then you drop your 2 years overall to your relapse-free survival in an upon adjuvant treatment in this high-risk macroscopic population to 50 or even below 50%. So keep this in mind, because now I think we come to that, and it's my hobby, and I still believe that this is the way to go to the neoadjuvant setting. Why do we think that neoadjuvant setting is so much better than adjuvant setting? First of all, you're sure you can judge the response rate, and that way you can really alter your adjuvant therapy. But conceptually also, we think that if you remove the whole tumor and then start then your adjuvant immunotherapy, then you can activate your T cells only against micrometastasis. And we know from preclinical models that a small micrometastasis is often not very immunogenic, and you have the disadvantage that you don't have the wide variety of the tumor in your immune response. If you start the immunotherapy upfront, then you get a broader immune response and a deeper immune response. We have shown this and proven this in the Opassant trial, where we compared adjuvant and neoadjuvant two courses. This trial was 4 courses, but for the TR, we just took the 6 weeks differences. And here you see that indeed the neoadjuvant therapy expanded the tumor resident clones in the periphery much better than the adjuvant therapy, even if it was exactly the same treatment. Updated data now from this trial show really, and I remind you, this population has a 50% 2 years relapse-free survival. And you see now with the small trial, we saw already an 80% plateauing with an overall survival for this population at 4 years now for 90%. Yeah, was a small trial. Therefore, you want to see larger cohorts. And this we have also presented this year. Now the 2 years data from the Opassant Neo trial, 86 patients. We analyzed in this trial different schemes of the combination ipi-nivo with the idea to reduce the toxicity but preserve the efficacy. And this was really achieved by reducing the ipi dosing. And this is completely different towards the adjuvant setting. Here, the ipi-1, nivo-3 is equally effective but is way less toxic. And therefore, this was the arm where we have also proceeded, and which should be now next year tested in the phase 3 trial. Just to remind you or to show you now the data, similar to the small trial, we see that if you achieve a deep response with the majority, then you have this excellent outcome with a 98% relapse-free survival. Yes? And do you hear me? Hello?
Yeah, it's okay now. It's okay.
Okay. And while if you have no pathological response, so this small group of non-responders, then this is also an excellent surrogate marker for the long-term outcome. Quick going through, I think I have 2 more minutes or 3 minutes. Translational research, can we predict from baseline already the outcome of these patients? And yes, we can do this. We take the interferon score and the tumor mutation burden. And if you have both, then you have 100% response rate. If you have one of these two, then you have 80 to 90%. And if you are low, then you have, unfortunately, only 1/3 of the patients have response rate. Improving this now in using these information also for personalizing the therapy. This we have done in the Prado trial. What do we have done in this? We placed an index marker in the largest node at the beginning. Then we gave only 2 courses ipi/nivo, removed only this small node. And if you had a good response in this node, then no completing lymph node dissection was done and only follow up. If you have a partial response, still completion lymph node dissection was done. And then if you have no response, what I've showed you this patient in need, then we escalated the therapy, giving all the adjuvant and allowed all the radiotherapy in parallel to them. The response rate was again high. Now with the homogeneous population from the arm A with a major pathological response rate of 61%, which is about twice what we see from neoadjuvant PD-1 monotherapy. The surgery-related adverse events were about half if you had undergone only the index node procedure. So we improved the quality of life of the patients dramatically. No grade 3 toxicities, and the quality of life for all these patients that had only the smaller surgery was much better. The relapse-free survival data will come end of this year. Personalization, last slide. I've showed you that the interferon signature is a nice signature to predict whether the patients will respond or not to ipi/nivo, and we addressed this question now. Can we already now de-escalate the neoadjuvant therapy versus escalate the neoadjuvant therapy based on the interferon signature? If you are high, then you get only anti-PD-1 or anti-PD-1 plus HDAC inhibition. And if you are low, then we give the doublet or even the triplet CTLA-4, PD-1 and HDAC inhibition. This trial is really flying like crazy, and I hope I will show you the data at ASCO next year. With that, I'm almost done. Quick switching from RNA-seq data to DNA-seq data. Very nice presentation from Kevin Litchfield from the Swanton Group at ESMO, where they analyzed 1,000 tumors across different malignancies and showed that TMB is the biggest predictor for response to checkpoint inhibition. Also, CXCL9 was found, and now also the TREF2 pathway. So if you have TREF2 loss, then you were more sensitive to the checkpoint inhibition. Why is this? If a TNF is produced in the tumor environment and via the TNF receptor signal is given, then you can go into the TREF2 pathway or the RIPK1 caspase 8 pathway. If a tumor has a TREF2 loss, then this signal, which is no cell death of pre-densin, is shut off, and then you get a preferred signal for a cell death of the tumor cell. This was found by a CRISPR screen, also from Daniel Paper. You see here the highest hit was TREF2, and if you then knocked out TREF2 in the tumor and exposed it to TNF, then it was way more sensitive for toxicity than if it was not. And this was also shown in the mouse model. And the spin-off from the NKI is now developing molecules targeting the TREF2 biology. With that, I would like to end. Thank the patients and the families, my very talented MD PhD students who run these trials, Daniela Tomant and the basic researcher around the Donald Pape and Ton Schumacher, my collaboration research at the NK Alexander Okoy for the whole team, the quality of life analysis that I've shown you were done by Noel van der Heuvel, my long-term collaborator Georgina Long. And I would like to remind you, if you want to make a neoadjuvant trial, then just contact the International Neoadjuvant Melanoma Consortium. They are helping you with all of that. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Dr. Blanc. We will have the online discussion after the second and the third speaker. I remember to all the participants that in this online discussion, they can raise their hands and we will can give the voice to make the question, or they can ask questions in the chat too. The second speaker is Dr. Joan Albanel. Dr. Joan Albanel is an international reference in breast cancer. At the same time, he is one of the most brilliant investigators I know. And not of less importance, he's a great person. Please, Joan.
Yes, can you see the screen?
Yeah.
Do you see the slides?
Yes, doctor.
Okay, so I want to thank Antonio Cubillo and Luis Costa for organizing this meeting, which I think it's great. We are seeing the advantages of this online method, which of course also has its advantage, but I think we have the opportunity to have a great panel of speakers, and I am very honored to be one of them. I also want to thank the kind words of Antonio. I am really thankful for what you meant.
Joan, tienes yes. que poner grande la presentación.
Okay. Okay, do you see it well now?
Okay.
So I am going to talk about breaking news in breast cancer immunotherapy. And as Luis Costa suggested yesterday, and I took his word for this presentation, is to be very practical in terms of what the oncologists, especially with dedicated to breast cancer, should know for the practice. So I will start with advanced luminal disease. There is kind of a disclaimer that compared to other diseases like melanoma in the prior talk, and a reality is that the immune environment in luminal breast cancer is quite different and not optimal for immunotherapy to work, at least with the current therapies. It's characterized by low PD-L1 expression, low percentage of TILs, presence of T-rex, and low immunogenicity. In addition to this, and I think this is common to the majority of tumors, but it's important to keep in mind that the immunogenicity and the general potential for immune response in primary tumors is higher than in metastasis, and in metastatic patients is higher in first line than in advanced line. So I think it's important to keep in mind these two concepts when we see the results in breast cancer. In advanced luminal disease, the results are generally very poor. Pembrolizumab as monotherapy in previously treated patients had an overall response rate of 12%, but only in PD-L1 positive patients. When patients are not PD-L positive, the response rate is from 0 to 2.8%. There was a hope that pembrolizumab combined with abemaciclib or other CDK4/6 inhibitors could work. The response rate seen in a phase 1 trial was 14%, and this year were presented the data at ASCO on the combination of abemaciclib, pembrolizumab with or without aromatase inhibitors. And despite a response rate that was not negligible, the overall toxicity profile and the benefit risk assessment led to the discontinuation of these combinations. Just one note, when luminal breast cancer has a BRCA mutation, then there is a chance of benefit that remains to be proved in phase three trials of the combination of olaparib with immunotherapy, in this case, durvalumab. This is the Mediola study that has been published this year, and the primary endpoint of the study was the disease control at 12 weeks. This was achieved in 24 out of 30 patients. There were patients with hormone receptor positive disease, also triple negative, and the potential benefit seen of this, with this combination was independent of whether the patients were triple negative or luminal. Still, it's not clear what subsets benefit, and there is a that this justifies a randomized trial, because the results appear superior to what is achieved with PARP inhibitors alone. Now I move to early luminal disease. Just to be to the point, there is an old study that has been published this year, is the SPY2 trial. And in this trial, there were patients with luminal breast cancer that were treated in the neoadjuvant setting with paclitaxel or pembrolizumab and paclitaxel, followed by doxorubicin and cyclophosphamide, and then surgery. This was an adaptive trial, very innovative, and the premise of this trial was that if is to generate preliminary data to estimate the chance that a phase three would be positive. In the study, in hormone receptor positive tumors, the addition of pembrolizumab resulted in a pathological complete response rate of 30% compared to 13% in the control arm. Based on that and this, the probability of benefit of the combination in a phase three trial was estimated higher than 99%. So based on these results, phase three trials have been designed in the neoadjuvant setting in luminal disease with pembrolizumab and nivolumab. I show these two here. I would not enter into the details. I add the worst trials as usual. So this means that we are not really incorporating a lot of biology in the trials. We're doing the old way that we criticize a lot, but we are still doing it, and we are happily participating in these trials. Now I move to advanced HER2 positive, mainly to mention two trials, the Panacea trial in patients with HER2 positive breast cancer, metastatic, highly pretreated, in PD-L1 negative patients, response rate 0%, in PD-L1 positive patients, 15%. Taking everything into consideration was considered that in this setting, the combination of trastuzumab and immunotherapy was not worth pursuing. And this is a second trial, the combination of T-DM1 and atezolizumab in metastatic HER2-positive breast cancer patients. And in essence, the study is negative, and the claim that the authors make is that the one-year overall survival rate was numerically higher in the atezo T-DM1 arm compared to placebo and T-DM1 only in the PD-L1 positive subset, not in the PD-L1 negative. Of course, it is not significant, and again, it's not a positive study. Again, the first trials are as usual, and there is a first line ongoing study with paclitaxel, trastuzumab, pertuzumab, with atezolizumab or placebo in first line with a lot of patients to be included. We'll see. In early positive disease, I just mentioned that there is also ongoing trials in the neoadjuvant setting. I have emphasized in these circles in blue, I don't know if you can see here, that there is a neoadjuvant phase with atezolizumab with standard therapy or placebo, and then we'll see the pathological complete response rate. But I want to emphasize that all patients receive in the atezo arm adjuvant atezolizumab, and this will make us very difficult to interpret the results when they come up, and more if we take into account the data that Christian Blanc has presented on the difference between neoadjuvant and adjuvant effects of immunotherapy melanoma in terms of disease-free survival. Now I move to advanced triple-negative breast cancer. You all know that, that there is a trial that was published in the New England 2 years ago with a combination of atezolizumab and nab-paclitaxel. And for those that are not expert in breast cancer, just focus that this is with nab-paclitaxel in first-line triple-negative breast cancer. The result of this study led to the approval by the FDA, and last year by the EMA of the combination of Abraxane and tezolizumab in PD-L1 positive metastatic triple negative breast cancer. So it's important to keep in mind that this has been already approved by the two entities. At the same time, we have to recognize what is the design and how is the statistical value of the study. As I mentioned, it's first-line patients randomized to Abraxane with or without atezolizumab. And then the PFS and overall survival were primary endpoints, but the analysis was based on a planned hierarchical look at in the intention to treat population, and then if positive in the PD-L1 population. In terms of overall survival, the difference in the intent to treat population was not significant, yet the data on overall survival in the PD-L1 positive population was analyzed and presented. Everybody says it shouldn't happen, but it happened. And the magnitude of the difference was enough, not statistically analyzed, but I think enough for the authorities to approve. And this year at ESMO, we have seen the final overall survival analysis of atezolizumab and paclitaxel. And just to summarize, the increase in overall survival is 7.5 months for a hazard ratio of 0.67. And I think that this increase is really significant and without precedent for many, many years for advanced triple negative breast cancer in the PD-L1 positive selected population. For practical reasons, I think it's important to say where we are going to determine PD-L1 in the primary tissue and metastatic. The data shows that the patients whose PD-L1 positive is determined in the metastatic tissue have a greater benefit than those in the primary tumors. Now, this year at ESMO, we saw a study very similar to the prior one with atezolizumab, but with paclitaxel instead of nab-paclitaxel. The results in the primary endpoint of PFS were negative, no significant improvement, but the surprise came when the overall survival data in PD-L1 positive was again not positive. In fact, the red curve is the placebo, which appears in any case better, but not significantly, than the atezolizumab. So this has generated a lot of discussion. The truth is that we don't know the reason why the two studies are different. Can be the chemotherapy partner, the fact that paclitaxel needs strong steroid premedication on a weekly basis, the trial population are different, also the play of chance. I think that this doesn't change the fact that one study is positive and the other is negative. Further supporting the benefit of immunotherapy in triple-negative advanced metastatic breast cancer, we also had this year the KEYNOTE-355, which randomized patients to pembrolizumab chemotherapy or placebo. I have highlighted the fact that here the study, the chemotherapies were taxanes or gemcitabine carboplatin. And in the patients with PD-L1 CPS equal or greater than 10%, the benefit was statistically significant in terms of PFS. So again, this is in accordance with a trial with nab-paclitaxel and atezolizumab. In the study, we do not have yet overall survival data. I highlight here that the benefit was clear also with pembrolizumab and taxane, and what appeared is that the majority of patients received Abraxane instead of paclitaxel as a partner. So I think this gives weight to the fact that immunotherapy and Abraxane can be beneficial. Now I move to the last part, which is early triple negative disease. Last year, it was already presented and published this year in the New England pembrolizumab neoadjuvant trial in early breast cancer. The patient received neoadjuvant chemotherapy and pembrolizumab or placebo, followed by surgery. And then again, something that I think it's worth discussing is that patients were randomized after that, or the patient in the pembro arm received adjuvant pembro, the placebo arm received placebo. I think this is not very consistent with the clinical practice. I will come back to this point later. The study had two primary endpoints. One is pathological complete response rate, and second is event-free survival. In terms of pathological complete response rate, there was an increase in 13.6% of pathological complete response in the pembrolizumab arm. And this benefit, and this is different to what happened to metastatic disease, was independent of PD-L1 status. The event-free survival data are immature, are not considered statistically significant. There is a trend to a benefit of in the pembrolizumab arm. But again, here there are two questions that are very important. One, what is the role of adjuvant pembrolizumab based on what we saw in melanoma? Maybe the major component of the effect is in the neoadjuvant part. And second, the patients today are treated not with placebo. If they don't have a pathological complete response, they are treated with capecitabine. This is based in this trial that clearly shows that adjuvant capecitabine is usually recommended for patients with tumors with residual disease after neoadjuvant chemotherapy. You can see here the benefit in terms of overall survival and disease-free survival. There are also some negative studies in the neoadjuvant setting in triple-negative disease. One is with durvalumab and chemotherapy in the neoadjuvant setting. There is numerically higher PCRs, but not statistically significant. There is a nice translational study, but I don't have time to go into detail. And then I think it's an important trial, the NeoTrip, in which atezolizumab was combined with carboplatin and paclitaxel, but anthracyclines were not given before surgery, were given after surgery. The result was negative. There was no benefit of adding atezolizumab to carboplatin and paclitaxel, but I think that the lack of anthracyclines is an important factor in this lack of benefit. We can discuss this later. Now, to finalize, I want to comment the study on neoadjuvant atezolizumab in early triple-negative breast cancer. Patient received nab-paclitaxel followed by doxorubicin and cyclophosphamide with atezolizumab or placebo. Again, we have the problem of the adjuvant treatment with atezolizumab or observation. Here, the co-primary endpoints were pathological complete response in the intention to treat and the PD-L1 population. One weakness is that the event-free survival was not co-primary endpoint in this trial. As in the pembro trial, we see a significant benefit in PCR. We feel that this can be clinically relevant, increasing 16% of pathological complete response rate. Again, this was independent of PD-L1, like the prior study. So to conclude, point by point, we can say that to date, in abdominal disease, immunotherapy has a modest and limited to PD-L1 positive benefit, but it's not relevant today for clinical practice. It's far from here. In early luminal disease, there is an ongoing phase three trial based on the SPY2 data. In advanced HER2 positive, we have again a modest but not relevant clinical benefit in PD-L1 positive. The trials have been conducted in pretreated population, so now there is a first-line phase three ongoing. In early HER2 positive, again, there is a phase three neoadjuvant ongoing. We'll see what happens. In advanced triple negative, I think the take-home message, very practical, more you are familiar, atezo and nab-paclitaxel are FDA and EMA approved for PD-L1 positive first time based on a 7.5-month increase in overall survival. In early triple negative disease, there is a significant increase in pathological complete response rate in two studies, when with atezo or with pembro. This benefit is independent of PD-L1. The event-free survival data are not significant, at least as yet, but I think we have to discuss and consider the value of adjuvant immunotherapy versus capecitabine in these trials. The last slide is that the view that I think is shared by all of us, that to advance in the development of immunotherapy in breast cancer, as in many tumors, it's essential to identify biomarkers of response and predictor signatures beyond PD-L1. There are others like signature of immune exhaustion that have been published recently, very promising. Also develop innovative strategies to convert immunological immunologically silent tumors into an immunotherapy sensitive phenotype. We can discuss that. Use in less predicted populations, at least with the current immunotherapies, analyze subsets like BRCA mutations that I show, patients with high TMB, or also develop cell therapy, which I think was very nicely discussed yesterday. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. John Albanel. Great presentation, just on time. I remember all the participants that we will have the online discussion of these three first presentations after the presentation of Dr. Jaime Pérez de Oteiza. Dr. Jaime Pérez de Oteiza is here with me. I would say he is one of the fathers of modern hematology here in Spain. He is the head of the hematology department here in HM Hospitales. And at the same time, he is an active research doctor, but at the same time, he is always next to the patient. And the first breaking news of his presentation is that he is going to get for our group, just in a couple of days, the first accreditation of cellular immunotherapy for a private group here in Spain. So this is a great news for us. Please, Dr. Pérez de Oteiza.
Well, good afternoon. Thank you very much, Antonio, for your nice and deserved presentation, introduction of myself. First of all, I want to thank the organizers for inviting me to share our experiences in immune therapies and for hematologic malignancies. And I want also thank all the attendants for being here in this pandemic style meeting, and I hope it is useful for you. Okay, immune therapies in hematologic malignancies are a long lasting story. It started a long time ago. Well, there's something wrong. Don't worry. Okay, yes, it's a long lasting story. It started with Donald Thomas, who developed the bone marrow transplantation in the 60s of the past century. And he was a charming person that inspired us, many of us, in this fascinating endeavor. With the bone marrow transplantation, they discovered the graft versus leukemia effect, in which T cells from the donor were killing the tumor cells of the patient. So it was the first way of cellular therapy. Well, later on, Keller and Milstein described the monoclonal hybridomas, and they lead to the construction of hundreds of monoclonal antibodies. Here you can see Milstein and Keller doing some after work activities. Well, what do we have now in hematologic malignancies? Well, we have monoclonal antibodies. We have immunoconjugates that can be monoclonal antibodies combined with toxins. We have also radio-labeled monoclonal antibodies. And we have another more sophisticated antibodies, which are the bispecific monoclonal antibodies, which are T-cell engagers. And of course, we have the checkpoint inhibitors that we have been talking about them for this throughout this meeting. And finally, we have the genetically modified lymphocytes, which are the CAR T-cells. We are going to talk some about these compounds through this talk. All right. So far, we have immune therapies for lymphoma, immune therapies for leukemia, and also for myeloma. Well, let's see what we have. Well, first of all, we had rituximab. In the beginning, it was rituximab. And rituximab, as you know, is a CD20 monoclonal antibody that destroys B cells, and it has been used for B-cell lymphomas in almost 30 years ago. And it has replaced the classical chemotherapy schemes. So now the R-CHOP regimen is still a paradigm in the treatment of B-cell lymphoma. Well, after rituximab, then some other sons and daughters came, and these were all some other CD20 monoclonal antibodies. And currently, we do have obinutuzumab, which is a next generation CD20, more active, more potent, more immunosuppressant. And it has been already approved for first-line treatment of follicular lymphoma in combination with CHOP or in combination with bendamustine. Also, it is approved already for first-line therapy of chronic lymphatic leukemia, either in combination with chlorambucil for frail patients or in combinations with ibrutinib in high-risk patients who have the mutation of TP53 gene. There are also some other next-generation CD20s, like ofatumumab. It is not so successful, this compound. And the last one, the new kid in town, is the CD19 tafasitamab, which is recently has been just in a few months, after a few, just a few months ago, has been approved by FDA in combination with lenalidomide for refractory diffuse large B-cell lymphoma. It's been explored in combination with other compounds, and we are running these trials here now. Well, one of the latest advances, it has been polatuzumab. Polatuzumab, for the use in B-cell malignancies, is an anti-CD79B monoclonal antibody combined with a toxin, which is monomethyl auristatin E, MMAE, which is a microtubule blocking agent. So polatuzumab, it binds to the CD79 receptor in the surface of the cell. It is internalized again with the B cell receptor, and then the toxin is released and it inhibits microtubule proliferation, so leads to tumor cell apoptosis. Well, we do have polatuzumab already recently approved by EMA in relapsed diffuse large B-cell lymphoma in combination with bendamustine plus rituximab. Well, what's going on with Hodgkin's lymphoma? We have had ABVD for 45 years since the first description by Bonadonna, and we had no new treatments since now. And now we do have brentuximab vedotin, which is an anti-CD30 monoclonal antibody plus MMAE toxin. And it was first approved for relapse, a Hodgkin lymphoma, but now it is approved for first-line therapy in combination with adriamycin, vinblastine, dacarbazine, which is the AABD protocol that is replacing ABVD for the first time, and also for first-line patients with high-risk advanced disease, stages 3 and 4. Also, of course, it's approved for monotherapy for relapsed Hodgkin lymphoma. Well, in Hodgkin's lymphoma, of course, we have the new immunotherapies. We have nivolumab and pembrolizumab. You know very well the mechanism of action. They are abrogating the T cell exhaustion induced by the expression of PD-L1 in the tumors. So both of them are approved for relapsed Hodgkin lymphoma, and we are waiting for to move up front to first line, but it will take a certain time. Well, For T-cell lymphoma, we were orphaned of new treatments for many years. And now we do have also brentuximab vedotin, which is the CD30 monoclonal antibody that I talked about for Hodgkin disease. It's approved also first line for anaplastic large T-cell lymphoma in combination with a CHOP variant, which is CHOP without vincristine to avoid peripheral neuropathy. And this is a major advance because we had only CHOP previously and the results were poor in this setting. And now brentuximab is also approved for cutaneous T-cell lymphoma, which are resistant to classical standard therapies. So we have also a new weapon to fight against these diseases that are really very, very tragic for this patient. They have a miserable quality of life. Well, don't be worried about this threatening molecule that is falling on our heads. Don't worry. It is the calicamicin, which is a compound that has been combined with the anti-CD33 monoclonal antibody, and it's approved for acute myeloid leukemia, gemtuzumab or sogamicin. Well, this was first approved a long time ago, but it was then canceled. The approval was canceled because the authorities were reluctant about its toxicity, liver toxicity, but now it has been reapproved also by EMA for first-line treatment of acute myeloid leukemia in combination with daunoblastin and RAZ. Well, also in acute leukemia, what do we have? We have for acute lymphoblastic leukemia, blinatumomab. Blinatumomab is a T-cell engager also. It is a compound that's combined variable regions of the monoclonal antibody anti-CD3 and the variable regions of monoclonal antibody anti-CD19. So it binds to the CD19 receptor in the B cells, in the blast leukemic cell, and it engages linked to the T cell, who finally destroys the blast cell by the release of granzymes of perforins. Well, I don't know if I do have, no, oh, sorry. Well, blinatumomab is a great advance in resistant acute lymphoblastic leukemia. And let's move to multiple myeloma. What do we have for multiple myeloma? We have daratumumab, which is the first monoclonal antibody in clinical use for the treatment of multiple myeloma. It's a monoclonal antibody of the CD38 group. And it has a different mechanism of actions. CD38, it is expressed in myeloma cells, but it is also expressed at certain level in erythroid or lineage cells. Well, the action is through different mechanism. There is a complement mediated cytotoxicity. It's also a antibody dependent cellular cytotoxicity and antibody dependent cellular phagocytosis. And also it exerts a direct tumor action. All these mechanisms lead to the destruction of the myeloma cells. There's also an immunoregulatory action which is less well defined. Well, here we have a seminal paper of the use of daratumumab in combination plus bortezomib, melphalan, prednisone for untreated lymphoma in a patient, older age patient, non-transplant candidates. We were active in this trial also. And in this trial, the standard of care, the prior standard of care for this group of patients with was Velcade, bortezomib, melphalan, and prednisone, and it was compared with the same combination plus daratumumab. Well, the addition of daratumumab had a major impact in disease-free survival. In the treatment group with daratumumab, the median disease-free survival for this population was 36 months, and in the control arm was 19 months. Therefore, daratumumab adds 17 months of disease-free life for myeloma patients who are not candidates for a stem cell transplantation. This obviously led to the approval both by FDA and EMA. Then with daratumumab also, we have more recently the approval of the MAIA study, which is daratumumab in combination with lenalidomide and dexamethasone. It was compared with other prior standard of care that was lenalidomide dexamethasone in newly diagnosed multiple myeloma who were not candidates for transplantation also. And we can see in this curve that the median survival in the daratumumab is not yet reached. It's 65%. The median survival is 65% at 36 months. And so this is significant difference led also to the approval by FDA and EMA for this scheme. So therefore, daratumumab is approved nowadays for first-line treatment in combination with bortezomib, melphalan, and prednisone for transplant in ineligible patients. Also, daratumumab is approved for first-line in combination with lenalidomide and dexamethasone for transplant in eligible patients. Moreover, it's also approved for first line in combination with bortezomib, thalidomide, and dexamethasone for transplant eligible patients. This approval has been just this year. And also, of course, is approved in second and third lines alone or in combination with Lendex or Vordex and some other combinations. Okay, yes. Well, I'm telling nothing about this. Belantamab is the last coming in monoclonal antibody, which is directed at a B-cell maturation antigen in multiple myeloma. We are working in this trial now, currently. And finally, I'm just going to do a brief introduction to CAR T cells, which is a mixture of immune therapy, gene therapy, and cell therapy. CAR T cells are genetically modified lymphocytes that have been transfected with a chimeric antigen receptor that make them much more potent in their cytotoxic effect against tumor cells. Well, they need a very, very difficult and time-consuming production process. And there are two major trials. First of all, the ILIANA trial in acute lymphoblastic leukemia who were relapsing and refractory to other treatments. As you can see, these patients were surviving and there's a plateau in the cure. So some of these patients are cured and those patients were really would have died otherwise. Well, for a refractory aggressive lymphoma, we do have the Juliet trial using the CAR T cell developed by Novartis company, and which is commercial already. And also we can see a plateau in the cures. So some of these patients might be cured, and these were a third line, fourth line patient with diffuse large B-cell lymphoma. Otherwise, this patient had no opportunity to live. Well, just some take-home messages. Immunotherapy alone or in combination is currently first choice in newly diagnosed patients with a variety of hematologic malignancies, including lymphoma, myeloma, and acute and chronic leukemia. And CAR T cells are already settled as a consistent therapy for otherwise incurable patients with leukemia and lymphoma. And hopefully, its use will move forward to earliest stages in the coming years. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Pérez de Oteiza. We can open now our first online discussion of this day. Please, to all the participants, you can raise your hand to make your questions, or you can write your questions in the chat. I have some questions to Dr. Blanc, Albanel, and Dr. Pérez de Oteiza. Please give me short and quickly answers in order we can make many different questions, okay? Sure. So you can give your opinion about every question, the three of you, okay? The first one would be, we were talking yesterday about, well, in my personal view, and I think Dr. Costa agrees, we have now a liquid biopsy ready to see very quickly if a patient in nearly every tumor is responding to immunotherapy, individual patient to an individual treatment. But many trials are not designed in this way. What is your opinion? I think, for example, Signatera is ready to see if a patient is responding after a couple of cycles. What is your opinion about it?
Stop.
Oh. You first, please.
Me first?
Yes.
Okay. For stage four, I think it's working well. We have looked into stage three, and the majority of patients, you cannot find the tumor derived DNA. So in unfortunately in neoadjuvant setting, it doesn't work, at least so far.
Yes, I think it's something that we should really strongly consider, particularly in the triple negative breast cancer setting. In fact, I want to share a personal experience. I proposed a very simple trial that was, of course, with some technical limitations, but we know that triple negative breast cancer patients that have ctDNA have a extremely high risk of relapse. So I proposed a very simple trial, proof of concept, with about maybe 20 patients to see whether immunotherapy could eradicate and for how long this ctDNA. And this could be then used for basis for future trials. So this approach was really discussed with companies and so on, cooperative groups, but at the end was not financed. And I think this highlights one of the things that I've been also saying in my presentation, that we're doing many trials in the old fashion, and that we are not all in line to really incorporate these new biomarkers from the very beginning. Maybe retrospectively, if something doesn't work in the total population, then we look. But I think we should also consider to incorporate liquid biopsy and others from the beginning.
Well, in the hematologic malignancies, the liquid biopsy strategy is being implemented and Hodgkin's lymphoma to date, but it is not still that doesn't play a major role. It's being implemented but not widely used, and it's not clear the utility. Moreover, well, in other hematologic malignancies, we do have also some molecular markers that are being useful for the identifications or relapses. In acute, in leukemias, obviously, these are liquid malignancies. They have, we can detect transcripts in the blood of the patients since many years ago, and we have been using that in chronic myeloid leukemia, for instance, to monitor the response to treatment and so forth. So in liquid malignancies, we had already that. And in multiple myeloma, we have biomarkers like the proteins. And so the major role for this strategy of liquid biopsy is being developed in Hodgkin.
Two short questions to Dr. Blank.
Yes.
First one, what would you think would be the best duration of neoadjuvant treatment in melanoma, if you have a general thinking about it? Mm-hmm. And the second one, if you have a patient, BRAF mutated with brain mets, which treatment would you choose for this patient?
First, the neoadjuvant, I think we should stay with the INMC's suggestion, 6 to 8 weeks. We do all trials only 6 weeks. There are beautiful data from Michel Teng that if you do this longer or shorter in mouse models, then the efficacy is less. So considering that we have this high response rates and considering that with anti-PD-1, there were longer and shorter treatments and they saw a tendency to a less response rates when you gave this longer, I would stick to that. Also for practical reasons, when you do a new trial, that you can compare this to all the other trials, that you design them in the same way, and then you can also set with your homogeneous population this into stage, what you achieve with your combination. With the question, BRAF mutated patient brain mets, that depends on whether you have symptomatic brain mets or asymptomatic brain mets. We have seen beautiful data now, repetitive from different trials, for example, from Hussein Tabi, MD Anderson, that the combination of ipi/nivo gives a 60% response rate in the periphery and in the brain. And these are patients that were mainly asymptomatic and not requiring steroids. So for these patients, I would go for the combination. For patients that are deteriorating fast, requiring high dose steroids, I would definitely start with BRAF-MEK inhibition, try to stabilize the patient, maybe also irradiate the largest lesion, no whole brain, but stereotactic radiotherapy, and then switch to ipi/nivo to try to consolidate it, what you can achieve.
Okay, two short questions now to Dr. Albanel. You have 30 seconds answers. You talk about patients with germline BRCA mutations and immunotherapy. What about somatic BRCA mutation? Would you test every patient for it? This is the first question. And the second one, could you give us an explanation about PD-L1 depending or not depending in the trials? You know, this is why sometimes the tumor is PD-L1 depending, why sometimes it is not depending?
Well, the short answer is, the second is, I don't know. The first one was on PARP and BRCA mutations. Well, I think that it makes sense also to test somatic mutations because the biology behind it is similar, and there are data that BRCA PARP inhibitors work also in patients with somatic mutations. So I think that trials could also incorporate these populations.
Okay, and two short ones to Dr. Pérez de Oteiza. The first one, you talk us about brentuximab in non-Hodgkin lymphoma with chemotherapy. What is about cardiac toxicity in this treatment? You have more cardiac toxicity?
Well, thank you for the question. In fact, we do not have more cardiac toxicity. The main toxicity when brentuximab was introduced was the pulmonary toxicity because it was used in combination with bleomycin with the ABVD, classical ABVD scheme. So the bleomycin was removed from the combination, and so the pulmonary toxicity is avoided. The scheme has also adriamycin, which is obviously cardiotoxic, but brentuximab did not add any additional cardiac toxicity.
And the second one, it's a different one. Imagine in a week you are the Minister of Health here in Spain, and you have to talk to the ministry in Portugal too, and you have to put in the country and a strategy for CAR T cell therapy. What do you think is the best strategy in Spain and Portugal? Perhaps Luis can tell us after the strategy in Portugal.
Well, the strategy, if I would be the minister, I would say CAR T cells for everyone.
What?
Just kidding.
Yeah, but about the centers.
Well, obviously, we do need to develop academic CAR T cells.
Yeah.
Yes, to
produce them yourself. Yeah.
Prices that we have to pay currently all the companies. The companies have made good jobs, obviously, but. The country and in a public system, the Ministry of Health should favor projects on development of academic CAR T cells.
Luis, can you give us your opinion?
I do agree totally. I mean, I think one of the most wisest things they can do right now with the Cancer Mission project in Europe is provide to all the people, all the citizens, what they need, which is common, such as what is common and proven in prevention of cancer and treatment standards and quality. And then the very high specialized therapies, some of them need to be delivered by some special academic centers, okay? Some really centers with high specialization. That of course they will receive patients from everywhere, but they need to be prepared for that. If not, it's economically impossible. I have one more question, if you allow me, to share with Albanel and with Christian. I was thinking about when you said that in the melanoma patients, those who achieve a complete remission in metastatic setting are those who are living longer. Okay. Well, I was wondering, I can't remember, Albanel, if in those subset of patients that are HER2 positive in the Cleopatra trial, did they find anything similar or not? I mean, in some way, can we make a correspondence to that? And also another point of maybe common discussion between you both is that you said that neoadjuvant seems to be more interesting than adjuvant, if I understood well by your words, Christian. Yes. So I think we have more or less maybe the same. I don't know if it is the same in HER2 positive breast cancer. So the neoadjuvant trials showed very good response to double blockade. The affinity showed some improvement with double blockade, but not so much as in neoadjuvant, maybe. The question is, what is the biology behind? I mean, is the entire two therapy also a kind of immunotherapy that if you provide complete remission in a metastatic, it means they are going to live longer? Is that also important that the antibodies see the tumor, all the tumor in neoadjuvant? What do you think?
Regarding the question on the HER2 positive metastatic setting, I am not aware of this analysis, but I think it's a really good question. I'll check if I can find this analysis. If not, we can ask whether they are going to do it. It's really good. And in terms of neoadjuvant, I think very strongly that I think the data that have been shown in melanoma also clearly support that. that when it's much better to give immunotherapy in breast cancer combined with immunotherapy and chemotherapy in the neoadjuvant setting with a tumor is present, because I think this engages responses, for instance, the interferon gamma response that is induced by anthracyclines and many other things. For instance, we see in the triple negative setting that the trial that did not include anthracyclines in the neoadjuvant setting was negative, the study by Gianni. In contrast, the other two big trials in the neoadjuvant setting included anthracyclines and had a response. Also in the metastatic setting, we have a study published in Nature Medicine, the TONIC trial, that used different chemotherapies in patients with metastatic disease. And the most effective to induce interferon response in the metastatic setting was anthracyclines. And this was followed by nivolumab and was most effective in those patients with a prior anthracycline. So I think that the presence of tumor cells and drugs that can induce a certain immunological response are the best way to use it.
Okay. I can also only agree
yes,
with
Christian,
you.
Yes, please.
Yeah, I can only agree with you. That's exactly what I think. Interestingly, and for the sake of time, I've skipped this, and the patients that do not respond to the neoadjuvant setting are the ones that do have a less broadening of the TCR repertoire. So, and these are mainly the T-cell clones that that are not below detection limit at baseline and then become detectable. So it seems to you have to broaden your anti-tumor repertoire, and this you can do way easier if you still have the wide variety of the tumor in the patient. Yeah, the chances are much higher that also the subdominant clones are somehow presented and the antigens, and then you get the broader immune response. But so far, this is only shown in melanoma, so the others have to follow.
Thank you.
Okay, I think we are on time now. Thank you very much to Dr. Blanc, Albanel, and Perdio Teiza. And Luis, I think we could move to the second part.
Thank you very much. You're welcome. Yes.
Bye. So now we have two great speakers also, André Mansing and Emiliano Calva. I'm going to introduce the first one. André Mansing, he works at our hospital. He's a rising star, and he was also trained at Start Madrid with Emiliano. And I think we needed something also to see on the other side that troubles so much the quality of life of our patients, which is toxicity. So let's going to see how he's going to approach the management of immunotherapy adverse events. Thank you, André.
So thank you so much for the introduction. I would like to thank both Professor Luis Costa and Dr. Antonio Cubillo for the invitation to be here. So my presentation is what's new on management of immunotherapy adverse events. And really there is nothing really breakthrough on this field, although we are managing these toxicities better and better throughout time. So for the sake of disclosure, these are my disclosures. And I have prepared my presentation with this structure. So I have a brief introduction. I'm going to talk about mainly about immune checkpoint inhibitors because that's what we use largely in our clinical practice. Then I'm going to talk about the immune-related adverse events management, the ones that are steroid refractory. And I think this is the area where the greatest breakthroughs have come out. Some new approaches, of course, and then the emerging new agents, which are also bringing new toxicities. So I'm going to start only by making a brief remark regarding the hallmarks of cancer. So we know that avoiding immune destruction is one of those hallmarks. And T-cell checkpoint dysregulation is really one of the greatest breakthroughs we had on the past decade. So we started with the melanoma and lung cancer. We know that we can target checkpoint inhibition at different levels, and I'm going not to deepen into this. So at the lymph node level through CTLA-4 blockade and the microenvironment in the tumor through the PD-1 blockade. So really releasing the brakes or pressing the gas here on immune agents. And we have a proof of concept in melanoma and lung cancer. We know that the clinical trials from before immunotherapy were largely ineffective. So chemotherapy produced responses, but not really much durable responses. And as we can see here on the right, if we overlap, and I know the statisticians would probably kill me for doing this, we can see that we have advanced really a really great deal between the carbazin and with the CheckMate 067 with Nivo-EP. And we see that really at 5 years, we have more than half of the patients alive. So really a great change with this kind of therapies. But, and as Dr. Christian Blank already showed us today, if we enrich these cohorts to the patients that really do respond and do achieve complete responses, we have over 80% of the patients alive and free from progression. Interestingly, in the Nivo-EP arm, we see that a lot of these patients are off treatment, so with the treatment-free interval that is really relevant. So, and as we know, checkpoint inhibition is gaining a lot of field, so the number of patients treated with immune checkpoint inhibitors is really growing. They are approved as monotherapy in combination with other ICIs, with chemotherapy, TKIs, and so, which they were historically used in later line metastatic disease and now are moving into earlier lines of therapy and even in the adjuvant setting, as we have seen today. So the approvals are getting larger, as we can see here on our left, and patients may do receive these therapies for years, as optimal duration is really unknown. We have experience in melanoma here, and we can see, and was presented at ESMO really in September, that the patients who did stop and achieved responses are free from therapy and progression at 5 years, so a really big data. And this is really the focus of my talk here today. What is the cost of these therapies? And mainly the spectrum of immune-related adverse events is really large. So we can have adverse events, of course, in almost every organ that we have on our body, some more frequent, some more rare and more dangerous also. And proposed mechanisms are really just models today. We have a lot of translational work regarding this matter. We can make the hypothesis that the breach of self-tolerance by expanding T-cell and really expanding the TCR repertoire or the B-cell diversification, because the anti-tumor response on cross-antigen reactivity, the tumor is of course destroyed, but we also release our self-antigens and there can be some cross-reactivity. The cytokine response is also an hypothesis that is being studied. So the granzymes and perforins, the immunomodulators that are produced throughout T-cell expansion can also be a method of adverse events. And really, I think this one a little bit frail. The off-target effects, we know that, for example, the pituitary gland really expresses CTLA-4, so the blockade may induce a reactivity there. And of course, the microbiome, which is gaining a lot of representativity on these days. So talking about the management of these events, we have to take into account this kind of thing. So we need to expect how often do these occur, when to expect them, how do they present, and really how do we manage them. So regarding the management of these effects, I'm going to center my talk really on the steroid refractory ones, which I think will probably be our biggest challenge here. And then for how long do we need to treat these patients? So starting here on how often do these toxicities occur, we can see that CTLA-4 blockade is really one of the big problems. As Dr. Christian already said, this is dose dependent. So 1, 3, or 10 milligrams in melanoma produced a spectrum of activity that was higher, but also produced a larger toxicity. And we can see that the most frequent ones are really the skin, the GI, and the pulmonary adverse events. And then with PD-1, really not a very significant number of grade 3 to 5 immune-related adverse events. And really the incidence also can vary among malignancies. So we, on the retrospective review, we can see that colitis was more common in melanoma and pneumonitis was more common in non-small cell lung cancer. So the spectrum can also vary depending on the disease that we are treating. When to expect them? Really, with nivolumab and also with Nivo-EP, the great number of adverse events really happens on the first couple of months, maybe the first 4 months. And then throughout time, they start to get really less frequent. So we can see here on the left that with nivolumab, mainly before the 16 weeks, and with nivo-ipi, the spectrum is a little bit larger, mainly the skin and GI adverse events, and also the hepatic one, which is really a characteristic on the CTLA-4, and then the endocrine-related events appearing really early on the course of the treatment, and then persisting throughout time. So also, immune-related adverse events can also occur after we discontinue immune checkpoint inhibitors, and this is really important. So we know that a small percentage, about 10 to 15%, can experience a clinically significant adverse events even before, after 4 months after discontinuation, and this can, the range can go out to 33 weeks. And in some trials, we have seen adverse events occur up to 2 years after the cessation of treatment, mainly with atezolizumab. So how do they present? Really, the spectrum of presentation is really broad. Dermatologic ones are really frequent. The most frequent reaction is the maculopapular rash, which contrasts with anti-EGFR, so with the acneiform rash. It is predominantly on the trunk and lesser extent to the to extremities. And also some rare manifestations such as lichenoid, psoriasiform, and so on. The diarrhea and colitis, mainly with CTLA-4 inhibition, abdominal pain, diarrhea, loss of blood, fever, and then the hepatic ones, which are really, really silent and usually on the first phase diagnosed via the blood tests. Then some more rare toxicities, such as pancreatic ones, and then the endocrine, which are really frequent, mainly regarding the thyroid, that can present on the spectrum of symptoms that is very, very broad. The pneumonitis is very frequent in lung cancer, although with PD-1, a little less frequent. The renal toxicity, ocular, neurological, and really rare, but usually very dangerous, the cardiovascular one. And then the musculoskeletal adverse events, which can be bothering to the patients, and there are rarely serious, but they can cause a lot of inconvenience to our patients and can be a challenge to manage. So this is a fluxogram which was proposed by the Gustav Roussy team. So we should prevent this immune adverse event. So we should know what is the spectrum of toxicity we are leading with. We can identify previous factors such as autoimmune diseases that were treated on the patients, inform patients and educate patients, which is very important. The baseline checkup, the on and off treatment follow-up, which is very important. Patients who do transition between immunotherapy to other therapies should continue to receive follow-up regarding these toxicities. We should monitor the baseline values and on the detection, of course, consider other than immune toxicities and eliminate what can be progressive disease. And then, of course, symptomatic treatment, inform the patient regarding the cares that they do have to have and what are the treatment options to treat the adverse events. And then, of course, the resolution kinetics is very important, because if we do a very rapid taper off of the steroids, we usually have a relapse on or recurrence of the toxicity. And of course, we have to balance that with the immunosuppression complications that are inherent to this kind of immunosuppression. So educate patients, so give advice regarding the most frequent adverse or symptoms that can rise with this kind of therapies. And then the management or the basic management of this IR adverse events is really not that difficult. So based on the severity of the adverse reaction, withhold therapy and administer corticosteroids. So this is the pillar of this resolution. And of course, if the adverse event improved to less than grade one, we can consider restarting the immune agent if we have a prednisone dose or equivalent, which is lower than 10 milligrams as by RCM. So really the multidisciplinary approach is really relevant. So consult promptly with relevant specialties in the area, and for moderate grade two, and this is an exception for endocrine side effects, consider low dose steroids for those who are refractory. And for the severe dose, attack early, start high dose steroids and have a slow taper. So this is the basic recommendation that all of us that use this kind of therapies do engage. And really important, if the patient does not improve in 48 hours, increase immunosuppression and don't wait, because early attack on this kind of toxicity is really, really important. I'm going to talk about the steroid refractory ones now. So starting with the gastrointestinal, which can present in a very, very nasty way. And if the patient is corticoid refractory and no response in 48 to 72 hours, continue the steroids and considering adding the anti-TNF alpha, the infliximab, or most recently vedolizumab, which is an anti-integrin, which can produce dramatic effects in 24 hours on refractory patients. Regarding the hepatic ones, one very important message is that infliximab should not be used on hepatitis, because it can further make the reaction more serious. So if the patient is corticoid refractory, add the mycophenolates, and then if no improvement, start to think regarding use of anti-interleukin 6, such as tocilizumab, because it can be very efficient in this kind of reaction, although we do not have a lot of evidence regarding that. Regarding the pulmonary adverse events, of course, if corticosteroids are refractory, infliximab is usually a very smart approach, and then can consider and produce dramatic effects very quickly. And then the cardiac effects, if the patient does not improve on the methylprednisolone pulses, which are really the main frame for the severe or life-threatening disease, we should go out with all that we have. So anti-thymocyte globulin, alemtuzumab, infliximab, immunoglobulin. We do have to attack this kind of toxicity very early and very hard, because if we do not, the patient will ultimately can die. Regarding the skin toxicity, usually easy to manage, but the pruritus can be a problem. So aprepitant can be here a very smart approach, gabapentin, or most recently the omalizumab, which is an anti-GI, which is used for asthma, but also for the urticariform rash, can be also an approach. Regarding tocilizumab, we know that interleukin 6 is really a mediator of some toxicity. So there is a team that uses tocilizumab routinely for steroids refractory adverse events. And this, as this paper was published based on that data. And as you can see here, the PCR levels or the CPR levels do correlate with the interleukin 6 levels and do post tocilizumab lower. And also the clinical improvement was really major, about 80% improved on this patient series. So this can be a useful approach on the corticosteroid refractory patients. And then on Nature Review, a very smart proposal, a very good written article. We know that these kind of toxicities are different in their genesis. So regarding these kind of toxicities which are steroid refractory, we should have a personalized approach. So first line management with steroids, of course, and mycophenolates. Second line management should involve an histopathological analysis, maybe flow cytometry to assess which are really the players here, because the dominant mechanism of injury can be different between the toxicities, and then target specifically these events with the different agents that we do have that can produce effects on these IR adverse events. And so for how long, really the most of the toxicities do resolve. Hypophysitis and thyroiditis are usually the ones that persist throughout time. And retreatment after adverse events on those that can revert to grade one. This is a retrospective series of patients that were treated on double blockade, CTLA-4 and PD-1, which is the blue bar. And then we see that when they are rechallenged with PD-1, anti-PD-1 maintenance, the recurrence rate, which is the orange and green bar, is really low. And so most of the patients can do progress to maintenance therapies and do deepen those responses that we know that correlate so well with overall survival. Regarding the outcomes after discontinuing ICIs, we also know that the ones that discontinue during induction mainly in melanoma, of course, in some other pathologies, but was not that frequent. If we do discontinue, the overall survival and PFS are not affected in a very dramatic way. So talking a little bit about emerging new agents, and Dr. Perez de Otea has already spoken of the structure of these agents. So the bispecific T-cell engagers and the CAR T-cells are producing a spectrum of adverse events, which is really different from these checkpoint inhibitors. And we are starting to see those technologies transitioning to oncology now for solid tumors. So we have anti-PSMA T-cell engagers with anti-CD3, anti-HER2, and this kind of agents are producing a non-significant proportion of adverse events. So this is called the cytokine release syndrome, so a non-antigen specific resulting of this immune activation. And we know that this is a spectrum of lymphocyte and myeloid cells that become activated and release these inflammatory cytokines. So as we see, depending on the severity, this is true, and interleukin 6 and interferon gamma do increase with these agents. And the PCR, the CRP correlates very good with interleukin 6, so it can be used as a surrogate marker. And we see with the administration of these agents that we can induce this kind of responses and pro-inflammatory cytokines. So this is the grading of the CRS, and I'm going to delve deeper into this. There is multiple classifications, and we know that tocilizumab and corticosteroids do work very well with this kind of cytokine release syndrome. So mainly the message is to the severe CRS, grade 3 and grade 4, or the patients that do have multiple comorbidities or older age that are grade 2, mainly attack early with tocilizumab with or without corticosteroids to avoid complications and ICU admissions. Prophylactic measures are also very important. So in the AMG 160, this was really a breakthrough. So those priming start low and go higher on the next cycle. The priming is very important. Dexamethasone premedication, as you can see here, that after optimization, we have reduced the incidence of CRS. Also with blinatumomab, which is the currently recommendations of clinical practice, end to end. So more patients are currently being treated with ICIs because indications are expanding. This can cause adverse events even after discontinuing the ICI. Prompt recognition and management is critical, such as the multidisciplinary approach. And then, of course, most of the adverse events are managed by administering corticosteroids, and steroid refractory adverse events should evolve towards a personalized approach. CRS is really a new spectrum of adverse events. It correlates well with T-cell expansion and elevated pro-inflammatory cytokines. And IL-6 directed therapy and steroids are do effective in rapidly reversing this kind of symptoms. So eye vigilance, prophylaxis, and anticipation is very critical on preventing this kind of reaction. So thank you.
Thank you very much, Andre. We will have the online discussion after the second talk of Dr. Emiliano Calvo. Dr. Emiliano Calvo is a world reference in early phase trials. She is the head of a STAR unit here in Madrid. As you know, STAR is the phase one trial group, the greater group, I would say, in the world. Well, he's in the committees of ASCO, ESMO, and another associations, and it's a pleasure to work with him every day.
Thank you very much for your very kind introduction, Antonio. I appreciate it, and also Luis and Antonio for the invitation to participate in this interesting symposium. So in the next 25 minutes, I will be trying to be speaking on this topic, but this is quite a wide spectrum topic, especially nowadays. So thinking of the profile of the, let me see, of the audience, we are mostly clinical oncologists. I think I will be focusing in some areas of improvement, challenges of clinical research with checkpoint inhibitors. These are my disclosures. And I will be dividing my talk into three parts. First, I will be talking about what I think it is a kind of IO bubble that is coming with IO drugs. Then I will be talking about clinical singularities regarding anti-tumor activity and also toxicity. And finally, I will be talking about something that is a real challenge in early phase trials, actually, which is the optimization of the scheme of these drugs. So let's get started. Here you can see that, as you know, we have been blessed in the last five, 6 years with a real revolution in the way we treat our patients. You can see that almost 20 different tumor types had gained approvals by the regulatory agencies with IO drugs. If we look at the settings or indications, almost 50 different indications have been approved for IO drugs. And in total, it is 6 very similar anti-PD-1, PD-L1 antibodies together with the anti-CTLA-4 and the T-VEC. So very great news. In the same direction, you can see that in the last couple of years, the number of active IO agents that are being developed in clinical trials have almost doubled, from around 2,000 to almost 4,000. And if we look at the IO targets, the number of IO targets also have increased tremendously, around 70-80%. Having said that, 4 out of the 5 most targeted targets are already targets that we previously knew. So the numbers are great, the metrics are very good. What can go wrong, right? But let's look at this in a different way. You can see here the number of active clinical trials that were running in 2019. And 2/3 of these clinical trials consist of checkpoint inhibitors, mainly anti-PD-1, anti-PD-L1 drugs. And only 6% of the IO drugs that are being developed in clinical trials are checkpoint inhibitors. So most of our clinical trials with IO drugs consist on checkpoint inhibitors. Not too much innovation there. If we go further, it is true that the number of clinical trials have increased dramatically in the last 4 or 5 years, which is great for the clinical trials unit, as you can see up there by tumor types. But look at below, this is a very important data. The recruitment rate has decreased dramatically, 70%, and it is not recruitment rate per trial. It is recruitment rate of patients per site per month. And this is something that we are experiencing in all the clinical trials program. In addition, if we look at the initial slide in a more critical way, you can see that in the initial years from 2014 to 2017, there was a steady increase in the number of new tumor types that were gaining IO indications and the new indications that were approved for IO drugs. But in 2019, and I would say also 2020, this number of new approvals have decreased. In addition, in the last 5 years, we didn't have new IO drugs according to their mechanism of action. And those data, I was capturing them in the end of 2019, last year, but with the update of this information from the Cancer Research Institute, you can see that it was true. You can see that not only because of the pandemic, you can see here on the right, but also in the second half of 2019, there was already a decrease in the number of new clinical trials that were approved with IO agents. So if we take this together, there is a relatively low single agent activity for these second generation IO drugs and targets. They need to be developed mainly combined with anti-PD-1 and anti-PD-L1 because of that lack of impressive anti-tumor activity. Most of the pharma companies are pursuing the same tumor type indications. And also, if we have the concern in financial toxicity and kind of space saturation, like the gases that are trying to occupy all the space, with a 60% growth in the number of IO pharma companies and a disproportional number of IO studies in relation to the number of targets and patients that are included, well, you can see on the right, the graphic is quite similar to this one. And this is the graphic of the housing bubble that happened in 2000, two decades ago, with such a collapse in the financial global situation. So I think we are here, you know, in the peak of that cure. And what I don't know is if we are going to be able to keep growing or if we are going to start to collapse. What we really need is a second IO revolution to prevent this IO bubble from exploding, you know. And for that, we really need to try to do rationally designed biology-based studies with IO drugs and combos. We have to use biomarkers and also be brave and address unmet needs rationally, cold tumors, acquired resistance, etc. So we really need to have a second revolution to rethink the IO drug development methodology. The second part is the way we develop this drug, the clinical singularities of these agents in clinical trials regarding antitumor activity and toxicity. And I would like to mention here one sentence by Professor Dan Bonhoff, probably he's the most influential oncologist in drug development, in clinical drug development in early phase one trials. And two decades ago, 20, 25 years ago, he was saying that there are no bad anti-cancer agents, only bad clinical trial designs. It is quite an opinionated sentence, it is true, but I kind of tend to agree, especially for those drugs that are not that good. Because if the drug is excellent, it is true that the clinical trial design is not that important. In the initial 100 patients, you already see bona fide responses, no matter the dose, no matter the design. And that is what we were seeing with the anti-PD-1s, anti-PD-L1s drugs. You were seeing patients doing very well with these agents. But when the drug is not that good, and that is the case for these second generation IO drugs, we really need to adjust the design of the clinical trial to fit that singularities, those singular characteristics of the drug, in order to be able to show how good that anti-cancer agent is. And I believe, I really believe that we currently underappreciate, underestimate, undercapture the clinical singularities of our IO drugs in the clinical trials that we are running, in general terms, of course. Let me go further. Let's start by antitumor activity. Well, it's not only that with IO drugs we see hyperprogression or pseudoprogression, which is quite colorful. It is also true that when you have an stable disease or partial response or complete response with these agents, it is a different profile of response. It is a more prolonged, durable response than with chemotherapy or targeted agents. The one that was very striking to everyone was pseudoprogression. You already know, patients that are having IO treatment, the disease is progressing, but in spite of that, the patient is feeling better regarding tumor-related symptoms. You keep the patient on treatment, and then the tumor has a shrinkage because the progression was due to T cells infiltration. Okay. That happens very infrequently, no more than 5%, depending on tumor types. At the beginning, we thought it was much more frequent because it is quite colorful, visible, and you tend to magnify that. But the truth is that it is not that frequent. But based on pseudoprogression and nothing else, different groups were developing other ways of measuring antitumor activity under IO drugs, and other criteria were coming. The IRRC, the IR-RECIST, the I-RECIST, the IM-RECIST. Probably the best one still to be validated is the I-RECIST. But that is a picture, that is a frame in the movie, a picture of the movie. What we really need to have with these clinical trials is a dynamic idea of the antitumor activity. Let me go further on this. You can see here the typical actuarial survival curve for IO drugs in comparison to chemotherapy. At the beginning, usually the patients in the IO drug treatment are doing worse, and then they cross over and they have a better plateau compared to the chemotherapy. And that is something that we see all the time with the different randomized studies in different tumor types. So it is very important to try to capture the tail of the cure. Over there is where magic happens with these agents. The beauty of these agents is in the tail of the cure. If we focus in the first half, it's nothing especially spectacular, you know. The benefit of the patients is that a small but real percentage of patients with advanced disease that get cured in the long run. And we need to design our trials to capture those time-dependent endpoints. Here I have put together two or three different clinical trials from the initial times that we were exploring these agents because of the longer follow-up. You can see on the left, the KEYNOTE-1 with pembrolizumab, lung cancer patients after 5 years, 15% of them remain alive. Also with nivolumab, CA-209-3. 5 years overall survival for melanoma patients, one third of them, kidney cancer, 30%, lung cancer, 15% again. There is one clinical trial that I think is especially paradigmatic to understand the importance of time-dependent endpoints in IO drugs, which is the CheckMate 67. Almost 1,000 patients, first-line therapy for metastatic melanoma, Nivo-IP versus Nivo versus IP. If we have a follow-up of 2 years, well, it looks like any other chemotherapy or targeted drugs. Nivo-IP and Nivo a little bit better than IP, but it is like a steady linear relationship, and you expect that to go further down, like it was DTIC or anything like that. But if you go further in the follow-up time, you see how those cures become horizontal, and then you have a plateau of 50% of the patients, half of the patients with advanced metastatic disease that remain alive. But it is not only overall survival. Let's see PFS. One third of the patients long term remain not only alive, but also free of progression, which is very important because those are the ones that can get cured. We have a very interesting example. Probably Professor Costa knows that because it is the CheckMate 214 for kidney cancer patients, first line therapy, Nivo-IP versus sunitinib. Here, if you look at the PFS, which is a classical endpoint, surrogate endpoint for chemotherapy or targeted agents, after 1 year of follow-up, you see both cures. They are just the same. It is like all the patients were receiving the same treatment. Median PFS 9.7. But if you keep on going in the follow-up time, after 2 years and a half, you see how the curves separate in a statistically significant way, and you have a clear benefit for those patients that were receiving Nivo-IP. Another time-dependent endpoint, even more important, is the treatment-free interval, treatment-free survival, treatment-free rate, because these patients are not only alive long-term, they are not only free of progression, but they are free of additional treatment. They are just like they were not diagnosed of cancer. So that is the ideal endpoint for any patient with advanced disease with any of our treatments. And that is something that occurs in a percentage of the patients with these agents. In the CheckMate 67 again, of that half of patients that are alive after 5 years, three quarters of them, 75% of them, are free of treatment. Isn't that incredible? That is happening. The same for the kidney cancer series. It's a little bit more complex. This is slightly more technical. You have to believe me here that those patients that were discontinuing treatment with Nivo-IP, 40% of them remain treatment-free after 2 years versus 12% with sunitinib. So here, the beauty of IO drugs is that they are able to produce that percentage of patients that are cured or treatment-free. So the clinical trials with IO drugs need to use IO endpoints. This is something that is mandatory if we want to know the drug. Landmark overall survival, CR rate, PFS rate, treatment-free survival, time to initiate the next treatment, why not, overall value, quality of life. The biomarkers should be tied to IO endpoints, and we really need longer follow-up to be able to tell if the drug is good or not. What about toxicity? This is a summary of Andres' talk, great talk. Well, IO drugs are different animals also regarding toxicity, not only because of the different side effects, but also because of the different pattern of those side effects. Usually, these side effects are organ-specific. We don't see multi-organ toxicity as we see with chemotherapy. Usually longer duration, weeks, months, sometimes shorter duration if it is an acute side effect. These tend to be dose independent or quite independent of the dose. They are more dependent on the exposure. That means that if you reduce the dose, it will not help, something that you can do with targeted agents or with chemo. The onset sometimes is hyperacute in a matter of minutes. Sometimes it is late or chronic, or even after discontinuation of the treatment, you can see these side effects of IO drugs. And the management is not supportive care. The management is trying to mechanistically neutralize with antidote the immune activation of the patient with steroids, etc., as Andre was saying. So altogether, because of the duration of the AEs, the resistance to the treatment of the AEs, the side effects of the neutralizing treatment, you are changing one disease by other disease, which is chronic steroid treatments. And the need to discontinue the IO drug after these severe toxicities, I would say that the CTC AE criteria for grading the toxicity, it is underestimating the toxicity that is suffering these patients on IO drugs. Let's say a patient on chemotherapy with 3-4 diarrheas per day, stools per day, the same patient with IO drugs and the same frequency of diarrheas, probably it wouldn't be a grade 2. Functionally, the patient with IO drugs and grade 2 diarrhea is having a more severe toxicity. The same with the acute toxicity. Many times with the cytokine release syndrome and other side effects with IO drugs, the definition is not so objective. It depends more on the way you react to hypotension, to O2 saturation, hypoxemia, etc., than to specific figures of numbers of blood pressure or O2 saturation. And grade 2, grade 3 is the difference between a DLT or not DLT, is the go, no go for that patient on that drug. And then I want to speak a little bit about hyperprogressive disease. And this is CT scans, and I'm talking about toxicity, not antitumor activity. You can see the classical example by Gustave Roussy Institute, a patient that is having acceleration of the disease that is induced by the IO drugs. And below is a patient of ours. Actually, I think this patient was referred to our program by Dr. Antonio Cubillo. And this lady started treatment in September 11, 2017. 1 week afterwards, she was breathing worse. We thought it was a pulmonary embolism. We did a CT scan, and we saw how the disease was growing in an incredible way. You can see that lung metastasis in one only week. Believe me, it was growing that way. So that is a toxicity. That is a toxicity. It is a severe toxicity. And if HPD is real, which is real, and we have a doctoral thesis next month defended by Dr. Ana Gomez establishing that, it means that 15% of the patients, which is more or less the frequency of hyperprogressive disease, 15% of the patients have grade 4 or grade 5 toxicity, life-threatening toxicity, because of hyperprogressive disease. So if we go to the CheckMate 214 in kidney cancer, nivo-ipi versus sunitinib, it is very apparent that patients on sunitinib are having a higher frequency and worse intensity of side effects. But what about if I tell you that those on the nivo-ipi were having dose discontinuation of therapy in 22% of them, and with sunitinib only 12%? What about if I tell you that one third of the patients with nivo-ipi were requiring high dose chronic daily steroids? And what about the hyperprogressive disease percentage that we don't know? So looking at the data in a different way, it might be not so obvious that Nivo-IP was better tolerated. Apparently, I mean, according to this, it's hypothetical than sunitinib. And finally, 4 more minutes, I know, Antonio, for a scheme optimization. This is a nightmare. We are unable
to... 3 minutes, Emiliano, 3 minutes.
10 minutes, okay, thank you. I appreciate it. So this is a nightmare to try to optimize the scheme of patients with IO drugs. And this is because of different reasons. The first one is that animal models for IO compounds do not work well. We need mouse with human immune system and human xenografts. There are some intents, but we are not there yet. Actually, those mice models that are not perfect are more expensive to run a preclinical animal model of that characteristic than running a phase one trial. Another thing that Andrea was already saying is that those side effects usually are late and outside of the DLT window that phase one experts usually see for the go, no-go decision in the first cycle. So that is another challenge to identify the recommended dose. The DLT definition, it is a chemotherapy-dependent DLT definition. You suppose that the toxicity is associated with the dose. But actually, as we have seen, these toxicities, the heart toxicity, are quite independent of the dose of the drug. So more than dose limiting toxicity, as we are not reducing the dose, we just discontinue the treatment when this occurs, we need to talk about treatment limiting toxicity. And in addition to grade 3, grade 5 toxicity, we need to incorporate to that definition those patients with prolonged toxicity, intolerable grade 2 toxicity that makes them discontinue the treatment. And of course, if we believe hyperprogressive disease is a toxic side effect of IO drugs, that needs to be incorporated in the DLT definition. Also, and this is something that is quite counterintuitive, there is a flat relationship between dose of the different anti-PD-1s, anti-PD-L1s, as you can see here, and severe toxicity on the left or anti-tumor activity on the right. So the dose doesn't matter so much. And actually, if you review the different early phase trials for the different anti-PD-1s, anti-PD-1s, none of them are recommended clearly a recommended dose. They don't identify a maximum tolerated dose. And those are antagonists, which is receptor occupancy. If you go to agonist, that is even more difficult. You can see here agonist anti-CD40. This is the one from Roche, but the same happens with the one from Janssen, from Apexigen. These are public information. And you can see that the intermediate dose levels are the ones that are more powerful in terms of PD effects, toxicities, and anti-tumor activity. It is a kind of bell-shaped profile. So how to find the ideal dose, right? There is a very interesting, very nice review by Mark Retain from Chicago telling us that actually, if you give the patient 3% of the recommended dose of nivolumab, you still have maximal receptor occupancy and the same response rate in terms of objective partial responses and duration of response. So it seems like the dose is not that important. The exposure is more important. You can see here with Nivo, with EP, those patients with higher C-TRAF levels are the ones that are having a better response, and with ipilimumab also toxicity. And the same happens with pembrolizumab. There are two recommended schemes by the FDA, 2 milligrams per kilo or 200 milligrams Q3 weeks. And this came from this type of AUC versus dose and with real data and simulated data. And you could see that the two different schemes were having similar AUC levels. But if you go further in the same publication, you can see that a dose that is 25% lower than the recommended dose, 150 versus 200, is achieving the same exposure. So you don't really need to go so high or so frequent.
You're on time, Emiliano. You are on time.
Okay, fantastic. How many more minutes?
No more.
Okay. So just to summarize at the end, it's the last slide. So we really need to assess the recommended dose, trying to find the optimal immunological dose at the right moment, early in the clinical development of the drug. We need to have the patients to be very informative with PK, serial PD information, activity, short-term and long-term toxicity, long-lasting duration of therapy, backfilling cohorts, windows opportunity studies, Bayesian methods. So we really need to change the design. And instead of trying to have those running studies, probably it is more smart to do those ranging studies to try to find sometimes the right way in the upper levels, the optimal immunological dose. And that was all. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Emiliano.
Thank you.
Great, it was great. Antonio, so I will follow the discussion, okay? First of all, I cannot see questions from the audience here written. So until we are waiting for them, I'm gonna start. I mean, it's very interesting that Emiliano, you and Andre somehow touched in common points, and I had some questions for both of you. One of them was about hyperprogression, okay? Indeed, this is rare phenomenon. Thanks God is a rare phenomena, the hyperprogression. But one that happens is terrible because, you know, it's a disaster for the patient. And even without hyperprogression, the first part of the curve, the first part of the curve is disappointing for the patients in immuno-oncology, because it seems they are going worse than the other patients. Until then, the curve crosses over and you reach a plateau. So with your experience, and you, Andrea, please also let me know, in how can we improve, I mean, besides the biomarkers, in the something like that, how can we improve to detect which are the patients that, despite of not having, for instance, a great response, early great response, and having some side effects, important side effects, we should continue, but probably because these patients are going to survive and being alive for a long period of time. What is your opinion on that?
Yeah, well, that's a very important question from a practical perspective in our day-to-day life as oncologists. And here, up to date, we have to be guided by our clinical judgment. If the patient is developing more symptoms, tumor-related symptoms, you have to suspect that the patient is having a real progressive disease. It's not going to be pseudo-progression. I mean, it's, statistically speaking, it's quite clear that idea. And if those symptoms are being developed very early, in a matter of 2, 3, 4, 5 weeks, you really need to stop treatment and do a CT scan and compare with the baseline. And if the disease is progressing, no matter if it is hyperprogressive or it is real progression, but is deteriorating the patient, then I think it is time to switch the treatment. In a more formal way, because that is like a conventional approach for treatments in practical day-to-day life, in a clinical trial, I think it is mandatory to have also, if possible, a pre-baseline CT scan. The CT scan that was showing progressive disease to the previous treatment, and then you repeat a baseline scan before starting the clinical trial, so you can see the different tumor growth rate or the tumor growth dynamics before IU drug and then with IU drugs. And if that is changing and there are some mathematical formulas that are easy to apply actually, you are having hyperprogressive disease. But from a practical situation, no academic situation, just practical, if the patient is deteriorating with tumor-related symptoms, you need to think that the patient is having a real progression and act according to your medical judgment.
Okay, so on the same sense, but on the other side of the line, for you and for Andrea, now imagine that you have a patient that is responding on the tumor, is feeling better, but is appearing with severe symptoms, adverse events. I mean, How far can we, of course, we have to respect the guidelines because some adverse events can be really dramatic, but how far can we go trying to push the treatment in order to achieve a complete remission? That's going to say, for instance, as we know, this is so important for melanoma.
I would have to say on that line of thought that we have to be really careful with a severe, or when we suspect that the adverse event is severe, because in that case we have to attack early and we have to slowly taper off the steroids after, not to have the recurrence of the adverse event. Those are the patients that usually in melanoma, and we are seeing that in other diseases, that do achieve complete and partial responses. So the patients in the 067 trial on nivo-ipi that had toxicities and that stop around the second, third cycle of induction, they did have corticosteroids administered, they stopped the treatment, and they are treatment free as of today. So really, on those patients that are responding and have a severe adverse event, I think we can't worry too much about not achieving the response, because that response is maintained although the patient is not on treatment. The problem is what Emiliano was saying, that the grade 2 toxicities that are really, really bothering the patient. And we do have to start to increase the corticosteroids, and we arrive to a binomium of maintaining the therapy or maintaining rising the steroids, and we have to do a troublesome choice on managing those patients. Usually those patients have a very low or not so deep partial response, stable disease, and we know that if we do not treat those patients, they are ultimately progressing. So on that kind of patient, we do have to balance quality of life and talk with the patient regarding those adverse events and be really clinical, because as of today, we do not have any other tools doing that. I don't know if Emiliano agrees.
Yes, I totally agree, Andre, with your comments. Indeed, I think that the ideal situation, but we are not there yet, is to be able to have a kind of liquid biopsy that reflects the signature of the immune status of the patient, like a immune PD signature that tells you how is the interferons, interleukins level, cytokines, etc. That is telling you that the anti-tumor immune system of the patient is activated and is real. So you find that, probably you can be very safe and comfortable discontinuing the treatment, you know, and then you can repeat those kind of liquid biopsies with time. And if for any reason the patient is losing that immune signature, you can provide with a boost, you know, if the toxicity was not that bad or whatever. So that would allow us also to interrupt the treatment, not because of toxicity, just because the patient is already with a response and is 2 years, 3 years with the drug, and well, the patient might be better off without treatment, you know?
Okay. I think we are approaching the time. I'm going to give the word to Antonio. Antonio, do you have any questions to?
Yeah, I have a question for both. Both of you talk about we can find a toxicity after 2 years, the end of the treatment. I would ask which one, and how can you connect this toxicity, you know, 2 years later?
I can start, and I think Emiliano probably remembers a patient we treated at Start Madrid. It was a urothelial metastatic patient which had a complete response to the combination immunotherapy. And on the time I arrived there on the Start Institute, he already had stopped the therapy. So on those visits, the patient was tapering off the corticosteroids due to an immune adverse event. It was an arthritis, both on the knees, and the patient was walking with orthostatics. And when we tapered off the corticosteroids, that patient developed an uveitis really after 1 year with the immunotherapy, and the patient was off treatment. So I think that is very paradigmatic, and I have seen it in other patients. I just was the first time I saw it was there in Madrid, and I remember very good of that story.
Yeah, I was about to comment on the same patient, Andre. But yeah, it's true. If the arthritis is in big joints like the knees, and this happened with this patient, you can infiltrate with local esteroids, you know, and that is helpful, and you prevent systemic side effects from happening with the steroids. But sometimes it is not possible. It is in the fingers, small joints, etc. But yes, it is true. It doesn't happen frequently, thanks God, but it can happen. And it's not the typical diarrhea, pneumonitis, thyroiditis that you can see at the beginning. It's more this type of other side effects that take longer to articulate an immune, a self-immune disease of those characteristics.
Yeah.
It would be interesting to look for that. You know, nowadays we have series with a lot of patients treated with IO drugs with a long follow-up, and it could be interesting to see what type of side effects they develop once they have discontinued.
The real world series. Yes, that would be interesting. I agree. Antonio, you're already finishing our time?
Yeah, if you can talk.
Okay, just to say, for me, it was fantastic. I learned a lot. I believe our attendees also have the same opinion. Of course, they will be the kings to say afterwards what if they enjoyed this first meeting or not with the individualized immunotherapy. From my side, thanks to Antonio for inviting us to organize. And thanks to all the fantastic speakers. I think we have golden speakers all the time. And I think just to say, see you next time. I hope with the same spirit, with more science and with more practical things for the patients. Thank you.
I'm sure we are going to repeat this course. Thank you very much to our sponsors too. We already have more than 150 participants in both days. So, well, we are very, very happy with it. As we say at the beginning, it's a pity we cannot meet in person, but we hope next year we can meet. So thank you very much to everybody. And we meet next year, perhaps in Portugal, okay?
Yeah. Bye-bye. Adios.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Bye.